problem with people who treat this like a lifestyle instead of a job. I take great issue with that, because this is our job, and sort of buying our own hype is sort of unattractive.
Doesn't it get harder and harder to do the more success you have?
Well, what gets harder and harder to do is, like, with more success is that you start having, you feel separated from the rest of the world a lot. Mm-hmm. I mean, even, you know, because a lot of my friends, you know, have really normal jobs and mm-hmm. stuff like that. And it gets harder and harder to just do that. Plus, if you work as hard, if you take as many opportunities as I've taken to work, mm-hmm. I've literally not stopped working in 7 years. No vacations.
Oy.
So I, you know, it's just like one of those things where you have to learn to pull your own chute, I think, at mm-hmm. a certain point. Because, listen, at a certain point, I'm not going to be able to tell good stories anymore, because I'm not going to know anything but what it's like to be on set.
Right.
So, you know.
So are you ready for a vacation? Is that the end?
Well, I am. I mean, I'm going to take off 5 days between...
five whole days?
Yeah, Christmas and New Year's.
Wow.
That's my big one, because, well, we're producing, we are about to test Step Up 2. I'm uh-huh. promoting Hairspray DVD. We are starting to shoot 17, the new Zac Efron movie, mm-hmm. On December 3rd. We open Step Up 2 on the 14th of February. I start shooting the Adam Sandler movie February 11th. And I have a TV show that's going on too. So it's sort of like, you know, but this, you know, I'm supposed to, like, not drop the ball, you know, right. what I mean? Because it's too scary. And, you know, I sort of leave it to other people to, you know, try to go out there and be interesting and make really meaningful films for, like, right. now. I'm just really into being employed.
Well, you sound like an actor who's, you know, always waiting for the next job.
Well, you are, you know, and I think after I do the Sandler movie, I would like very much to find something that's a little more mature for me. And I've been really successful in the family genre. I'm very happy that I've done that, because mm-hmm. I think families are an unending source of story, and, you know, and I like making people smile and making people happy. And but I think, you know, after that, it's going to be time for me to try to show a dramedy in there or something.
Maybe
like
Madea,
that.
Medea the musical?
Yes, Medea the musical is exactly what I was going to do. So my cover's blown, the jig is up.
Damn it.
Yes.
I'm going to cover Variety tomorrow.
Oh.
So Hairspray.
Hairspray.
Speaking of things that make people smile and laugh and cry and scream. And
crazy, isn't it?
Yeah. I did a Q&A with you guys the other night at WGA for SAG-NOMCOM, and the audience was applauding and going wild for everything, and clearly a lot of people in that room had seen the picture once or twice before.
Yeah, wasn't that crazy?
They were completely into it. Is it exhilarating to see that kind of reaction?
I mean, that was crazy. That actually made me cry. I mean, I hadn't been at something where people were that into it, and, like, ever. You know, I mean, certainly not for anything that I've ever done, and I like to see people get what it is that you do, and then actually appreciate it in such a vocal way was totally overwhelming to me. And that was just a killer screening, though, man. Yeah. I don't know what you guys put in the juice at that one.
Johnny put something in the juice a little bit.
I'm telling you.
They love their Johnny.
Yeah, that was good.
But, I mean, did you pick this picture? Did you pick this material?
I begged for this.
Knowing that it was something that special?
No. I mean, I knew it was special to me.
Right.
I knew it was super, super special to me. But I didn't know that. You know, I felt like I had a very, very clear picture of it. This is the first, only, and could be only in my entire career movie that I'll ever make where I knew what it was going in, and it turned out exactly like how I saw it. And it looked like I pictured it, and it, from beginning to end, it was exactly what I thought it was going to be. And I can't imagine I'll ever have that experience again, you know what I mean? Because mostly you develop scripts or whatever, and then you make it, and the movie starts to take on a life of its own, and sort of ends up being different than what the script was. And then when you're editing it, it turns into a whole other animal.
Yeah.
And that's just kind of the nature of the movie making. Mm-hmm. And I think probably because you're locked into so many things with the songs in Hairspray, there's so many songs. And I'm also very, very lethal about, like, trimming, ironically, the fat out of the material that I work with, where if it's not If it's not making you laugh, it's not making you cry, and it's not turning the story, I tend not to want to languish in it in the kind of movies that I make. If I was making something like In the Bedroom, you can afford to sit and do a shot of Sissy Spacek looking out of a window for 20 minutes. You know what I mean? And that's actually a movie about meditation and reflection about what went wrong and all that kind of stuff. And so, but Hairspray can't afford that. You know what I mean? It's not interiors, you know, it's Hairspray.
But you have a lot of strong personalities around this movie.
I have a lot of strong personalities around the movie. None stronger than mine.
Well, is that it? Do you have to fight for, you know, this is the vision, this is what it is?
Yeah,
we're doing
every day. Every day. I had to tell them what it was going to be. And I was like, if you're going to hire me, you're going to trust me, and it's going to be kind of my way or the highway on this one. And I've never had this much confidence going into anything, and I had to fight for it for over a year. You know, they hired other people before me who then couldn't do it because of conflicted schedules.
Right.
And you know, it was I totally understood what it was, the director of the play and the choreographer of the play. And then when that ended up falling apart, I stepped in, and but they were looking at like 20 other directors, and it was going to hurt me too much if I lost it again because of my background with the material and my relationship with the composer and lyricists and all of that. You know what I mean? It was just a really intense thing for me, and it's something that I needed to make to nourish my soul, because as corny as that sounds, but I'd been making things that I had no real connection to for a while, and you know, it's funny, people talk about like, oh, all your movies led up to Hairspray. I was like, well, actually, Hairspray is the most me. Hairspray I could have made. That was my first movie, and it would have been the most me thing out there. The other things were like really great schooling to a certain extent, but the schooling was really about the politics and how to navigate the studio system, and how to, you know, when you're making, you know, preparing yourself for horrible reviews and scary screening, test screenings, and all of that kind of stuff. No one can tell you about how horrible that process is. Like, literally, that's it's the freaking worst, man. You know, having 400 people from Torrance tell you how bad your movie is and why. You know, it's just, it's like mind-numbing. You've been working on something for a year, and you know exactly what it's supposed to be. It's cheaper by the dozen too. It's cheaper by the dozen too, man. You know what I mean? It's not trying to be, you know, American Beauty. You know, and
but yet at the same time, you're reading reviews as though they mean something.
They have the exact same kind of impact. You know what I mean? And as nice as they were. You know, to say they're equally as mean to me. Right. And I was just going out and doing a job that I got, you know. I mean, it's not like I had to make Cheaper by the Dozen to, because it, in my soul, it was burning in me. I had to tell the story of the Baker family, the continued story of the Baker family, you know, and their foibles. But, you know, I've done what I've done, and it's not certainly not a crime against humanity, although some bloggers would have you think so. It's just important to keep kind of treading on, and I think with Hairspray was a great step for me in terms of like my personal evolution, and for me to take a step back and really go like, you know, I can do something I'm proud of. I can do something that makes me hold my head high.
Being the choreographer and the director,
It made it easier. I didn't have to and the producer, really. Right. So I didn't have to answer to anyone, really. And, you know, and the studio didn't really know exactly what to make of it, because
it's kind of nice to be in Canada sometimes.
You know what? It was great. I mean, just all around, it was a truly, truly remarkable experience. You know, making it was the great joy of my life, getting to spend all that time again with all those dancers, and to, you know, be taking all of those like kind of iconic movie actors and kind of making them step outside their current boxes and making them kind of, you know, Michelle Pfeiffer was like, I really never thought I'd see thought I'd see myself doing anything like this again. So, you know, kind of her taking that on was just like a delirious joy, you know. Oh, come on, I got to be in rehearsal rooms with like Chris Walken and John Travolta, like in jazz shoes and like little black jazz pants, like rehearsing a love duet. I mean, it was crazy stuff, you know?
And of course, I was disappointed when Jim Broadbent left, but it also seems like Walken was,
you know,
a magical fit.
Walken was a great fit, you know? I mean, because he's like everybody kind of revealed themselves to be who they are as characters. Walken's like a human right. joke shop, you know? And Latifah's a one-woman NAACP, and Zac Efron is a teen idol, and, you know... It was crazy, and Jimmy Marsden is corny as shit. It's crazy.
But you've kind of created a new career for him. Now I can't stop singing.
I know.
He's got to sing in everything now.
I know. Isn't that funny? And I think he made Enchanted before he made Hairspray. So.
But he's really good. I mean, that's the thing that was.
Oh,
I think the
he's great.
He's one of the great surprises of that picture because you know we all have a relationship. We didn't know Nikki and we didn't know Elijah.
Yeah.
You know, but we know him and.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. You know how that came to be because I was looking at you know all the different kinds of like Hugh Jackman and all.
Right.
I was like hoping to get snag somebody like that.
Yeah.
And David Rubin, the casting director, and Richard Hicks came and walked into my rehearsal and said, I think you should see this. And they popped in a videotape, and it was Jimmy Marsden on Ally McBeal. And you know, Ally McBeal had all those crazy, weird singing.
Right.
Arcs. You know what I mean? Everybody had to go down there and sing at some point. And I was like, all I wanted from that character was like a young Dick Clark. And with those crazy good looks and that voice that's like Frank Sinatra young or, you know, like a little Michael Bublé or whatever, and just that little kind of link that he has, it's like, we found him, it's him.
Right.
And I had to beg the studio for him. They really
That's kind
were
of
like,
funny, actually.
I had to beg for a lot of people. You would be surprised how hard I had to fight.
Well, Nikki and Elijah give you a lot of credit for their performances, but I mean, so you went through a lot with them, and Elijah wasn't a dancer. It gives one of the great dance numbers in the show, in the movie. But with somebody like Travolta, you know, or Chris Walken, how much do you direct, and how much do you just kind of put them where they're supposed to be and let them go?
You know, it's funny. I directed them a lot. They are both. You know, real actors in that way, where they open themselves up for direction. You know, with John, and I think we talked about this at the Q&A thing, you know, once he had the security of knowing that I was supporting him with the accent, he let me do anything at that point. I could completely direct him. And, you know, listen, one of the benefits of doing a musical is you got a lot of rehearsals. So when I got into shooting the scenes, I kind of knew what I was in for.
Right.
The big unknown with John was always like, how long his stamina could endure with all of that prosthesis on and the suit. But with Chris, you hire Chris knowing that you have no idea what's going to happen at any moment. You know, that's what makes him so great is his lack of predictability.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, he was just doing things that were like, you know, nutty. And then I could nudge him around if I wasn't getting something that I needed. But I sort of liked from Chris kind of not knowing what I was going to get, you know, because it just turned that relationship into such a surprise. You know, they were... God, he was like so into Edna. It was so crazy. It was like, just sitting there sometimes I was like, somebody just get me a straight jacket because this is getting really weird around here. But, you know, look at how anarchistic. It's like this great family movie with this giant number, a love song being sung by one man to another, two men to each other, you know, and that's the reality of it, and it's a beautiful thing, man.
Well, it's funny because you kind of made Latifah into this big comedy star, and then she's really the rock solid center of the picture. She's kind of the heavyweight.
In like Bringing Down the House?
Yeah.
She's funny in that movie. She and Eugene Levy are so funny in the movie. But you know, this is our second time we've gone to the well of you know, anti-racism. You know, and it's a good theme for us. You know.
Well, it's a good theme. I mean, it rarely has a. You have a problem. Don't have a problem. Dealing with it in true life, either. I mean, it's still there.
Yeah. Oh God. You know? Which is why I think Hairspray is successful at all, is because people sort of recognize the stupidity and the ugliness.
The thing about Hairspray, watching it again a couple times and seeing it that night, it reminded me that every character in the movie really has something to overcome.
Oh yeah.
They all have that, you know, that thing to overcome.
Yeah.
So when they're marching, they're not just marching for civil rights, they're marching for, you know.
The black and white thing in Hairspray is just emblematic of difference. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It could be about anything. Everybody, I mean, this is the thing that I think is hysterical. It's sort of like the thing that unifies people, everybody in this country, is the fact that we are all different, including every, you know, all the white people. We're all like of different ethnic persuasions and religions. And, mm-hmm. you know, so the idea of sameness is more the myth than difference. That's what, and so that's kind of how I approached it. And that's how I you know, really.
And that's the Caribbean there.
That's how I approached it, you know, because if it was just about black and white, that's right. Sort of, that's once again, that we, you know, go watch Mississippi's Burning, you know, mm-hmm. But this is about, you know, it opens with our heroine being being an outcast because she's heavy,
right.
You know, and so it's just all emblematic of the bigger picture, you know.
And Mark and Scott, we have not seen as much as some of the other people involved with this, but they really are kind of at the base of
The reason the movie's
this whole thing.
Yeah, they're the reason the movie needed to get made, because that's the compelling new element, is their score and the songs. And, you know, why would you just go and remake a John Waters movie? There's just no reason. They exist in their magnificence and for the very reason that, you know, he made them, how he, you know, it's his voice.
Yeah.
And with this new element, you know, it deserved to be told again. You know.
So, is your next thing to make more musicals? I mean, I really want
to make another musical, but I haven't found anything that's like jumping out at me that has the music that's good, because that's why Hairspray works, is because the music's so good, you know, and I would love to make another musical. I would kill, but I need to find the right one with the right message and the right, you know.
What would be the thing that you hear in your head and you know is
well,
the thing?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's at some point something's going to jump out and go like, make me, you know?
I mean, it's very easy to imagine you doing Xanadu.
Oh my, I guess it is, but.
But it doesn't seem like that.
I'm
would
actually
be.
Going to see it in it. I haven't seen it yet. I'm
it's
going to
fantastic.
See it in a week. Is it?
Shockingly, I went to see it by almost by mistake. I sent like 50% tickets out last summer.
Uh-huh.
You know, like offers, and I was like, okay, what the hell? And I got the tickets. I was like, we don't have to go, but we went, and it was the best time I've had in months.
Well, it's all like real kitsch. I just don't know. Yeah. It's at the center of it. Do you know what
it
I
may
mean?
Not be. It may be. It may not.
It's,
you know.
By the way, it's not like everything I need to make has to have like a message.
Well, that's the thing. It's more in the light work that you've done than the.
If I think that I can get people into a theater to see another musical, you better believe I'm going to make it. You know, I just talked to Stephen. I was recently at a party and Stephen Schwartz was there, who wrote Wicked, and I talked with him. I asked him where that was, and. I guess it's like nowhere. They have no deal. They have no plans to make it. It's not going to happen for a long time if it happens.
Mm.
So like the anticipation about that, just people should just kind of relax for a little while.
Well, not too many Sondheim's coming out either in a hurry. We have Sweeney finally coming out.
Well, we have Sweeney coming out, you know, which I am dying to see. You know, I'm sure it's going to be amazing. I mean, it looks like Sleepy Hollow to me. I mean, the trailer. Do you know what I mean? It has that same bluish thing, and Johnny at the center of it. But
darker.
You know, I'm just
darker. Think darker.
Oh, have you seen it?
No.
No, you haven't seen it yet?
Of course not.
Okay. Okay. Good.
I don't know when this is airing.
Exactly. Stacey Snyder actually I actually have to call her and say like when you're screening it again, because she wanted me to come in and see it, and I'm just dying to see it. But I'm sure it's. I mean, I know that it's Tim. There's going to be a lot of blood.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, the whole movie's about the blood, really. You know.
It's
so,
a bloody movie.
Yeah. So good for the kids at Christmas.
So do you think there's like resistance in the world? I mean, I think that Hairspray is one of the great joys of this year, and yet the media people, you know, the pundits and everything are kind of like, Hairspray, you know. They kind of tend to push it to the side, but I don't quite understand.
I haven't even felt that, you know. Well, we're in a time right now where all these, you know, great kind of Oscar-y movies are coming out, you know, and everything's about countdown to the Oscars, and I'm like, countdown to the Globes, you know.
They have a category for us.
Listen, we were, I think, the only movie prior to like what's happened this month that had better reviews than us were maybe Ratatouille.
Right.
You know, and we feel really, I'm really, really proud to just kind of be in that place, you know, and, you know, I understand why people would dismiss us. I mean, we are a frothy bubblegum musical comedy, and people don't really understand how difficult it is to make a movie like that, and how much goes into it, and how much rehearsal, you know, how much effort goes into being effortless. But I know.
Yeah.
You know,
well, I think the place that it will happen for people is when they watch it the second time or third time or fourth time over Thanksgiving, and their kids keep on putting that in the DVD player instead of No Country for Old Men. As much as I love No Country for Old Men, you know, how many times can you watch?
I'm dying to see. You know, but it's like when movies like that or Michael Clayton or things are around. Of course, people aren't the two big things that are coming up. Like everything Oscar seems to be revolving around Sweeney and Atonement.
Yeah,
but you know,
and there will be blood.
And there will be blood. You know, and. You know, so when people are putting their focus on that, of course you're going to dismiss Hairspray. Hairspray was like a, you know, thing that, but comparatively, but if, but we'll see what happens. You know, there's some just really, really rock solid performances in there. Yeah. And like I said, I took a big step as I think a director in terms of kind of the confidence that I showed in making that movie, because I got in there and I just wrestled that gator to the ground, you know, and there are a lot of naysayers, man. There were a lot of naysayers during the process, and even my partner and my sister, excuse me, my sister is my partner, my sister and my agent were very like, we don't know about this, I don't know about this, and I called my agent, I was crying, said, you have to support me, I need to do this, you know, that.
Well, there's more than a little to be said for joy.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, there's no quantifying it, man. You know, I think that's what's going on. So it's like if we did get any kind of recognition at all, some nominations for anything, it would be great if New Line would kind of do a limited re-release so people remember that and give it kind of a shot, you know.
Yeah.
I know they did that for Chicago. I know they re-released for Chicago.
Well, Chicago was a little, they were actually released this time of year, so it was a little.
Oh, right. It kind of just rolled through.
Yeah. It was actually went wide right after they got nominations, so it was a different, it was the Harvey system.
Yeah.
New Line summer system. But I think that's what, I mean, I do think in the end that's going to work for you guys because it has its place, and now people are thinking about these heavy movies, but then as you start to think about what you really enjoyed this year.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I know that we got an enormous amount of support from the HFPA, so if they see fit to...
Crazy foreign people love you.
Crazy foreign people love us. You know where we're really, really big and it totally makes sense to me is Japan. Mm-hmm. Because the whole pop culture-iness of it and all the...
Well, you were really big here. I mean, $130 million is not nothing.
Particularly
when you consider, you look at the numbers that, you know, look at these other movies are doing, these kind of darker movies.
Yeah.
You guys are the big movie on the block. If you guys, you know, in that race, you guys are the highest grosser probably of the entire group.
That's crazy to think about. Well,
it's a bunch of movies that are never going to do more than $50, $60 million, so, domestically.
That's true.
So you guys are kind of like the departed of this year.
Oh, my God. That's the craziest thing I've ever heard to think about that. I know. I'm really excited because...
Now you wish you had Nicholson with a black dildo.
It's going to sound terrible, but we're almost... at 200 million, and I think we'll probably hit our 200 world.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to go a little over because I wanted to beat Pacifier, which is because Pacifier right now is my highest grossing movie. And I'd really like it to be Hairspray instead, but what are we going to do? And, you know.
If only you get Vin and Drag, maybe it'll be a sequel.
Oh my God, can you imagine? Can you?
I don't want to. I'm trying to keep it out of my head, out of my mind.
That's some intense imagery, man.
Well, thank you so much for coming out to talk.
Oh God, thanks for caring enough to talk.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.